Middle force approach. Middle force approach. The indication for this middle force approach is tumor limited to the small tumors limited to the internal acoustic canal with the submissible hearing, because we are going into this area mainly to the lateral 2/3 of internal auditory canal through the middle fossa. So if you want to get a better understanding of this area, please see the video on anatomy of temporal bone. There I have explained the temporal bone in relation to anterior, middle and posterior fossa in a skull. So the door of entry will be, the ear comes almost here. So the door of entry will be anterior to the pinna. Okay, it will be anterior to the pinna, and we are going directly into the internal acoustic canal, mainly the lateral 2/3, and it is completely extradural also. So this is the only surgical approach for vestibular schwannoma for reaching into the internal acoustic canal with the preservation of hearing. Okay, there is no damage to the hearing in this case. So the indication I have already explained. That is small tumors of the internal acoustic canal with serviceable hearing. That is the indication for middle force approach. So position is supine with the surgeon sitting on the head end of the patient. And incision is anterior. Either this can be an incision like this, or we can also put an inverted U incision like this. In either case, after putting the skin and soft tissue incision, a middle fossa craniectomy is done, which is around 5 × 5 cm. Okay. And after that, an extradural approach to the upper surface of the temporal bone. On doing the craniectomy, this area will be reached. So the upper surface of the temporal bone and also the posterior fossa will be exposed. So after this, skeletonization of the entire internal acoustic meatus. And in that, we can see, identify the 7th and 8th cranial nerve, and the tumor is identified, and it is dissected out from the 7th and 8th cranial nerve. And after that, removal of the tumor and then closure. It is not at all easy, as I have told. It is technically very much demanding, very much difficult procedure. But the main advantage is that we can get a complete exposure of the internal acoustic meatus and tumor removal with preservation of hearing. And there are also some disadvantages, and they are the disadvantages. So the disadvantages of middle fossa approaches are, one is 7th cranial nerve paresis, though temporary, because this facial nerve crosses the anterosuperior portion of the tumor in most cases. So there is chance of a temporary facial nerve paresis. Second is retraction of the temporal lobe is needed in this approach. So this can lead to troublesome motor deficit, and especially if the dominant side is affected. Okay. And then is risk of dural laceration, especially in elderly patient. Then I have already explained that there is very limited exposure of the posterior fossa and also the CP angle. So the tumor is large in size, this approach cannot be preferred. And it is a technically difficult one. And there is chance of postoperative trismus. How it happens? Because at the time of incision and also at the time of craniectomy, there is chance of injury to the temporalis muscle. So there is chance of a postoperative trismus. So these are the disadvantages. So I explained the translabyrinthine approach, the retrosigmoid approach, and also the middle fossa approach. Now there is some combination approaches that from this picture we can very clearly tell the other approaches also. So these are the approaches in total. And other than these three common approaches, you should also know the name of these approaches, because this can be asked in theory exams. So, translabyrinthine, you know, this directly going through the labyrinth into the internal acoustic meatus. Retrosigmoid is like this. And the middle fossa, we are going through the middle fossa and reaching the temporal bone. Then translabyrinthine, translabyrinthine is like this. And and this is apex of temporal bone. So this part is also removed, or this is also acting as a corridor, that is translabral, then transapical. Transcochlea is again going like this. Cochlea is also involved. Cochlea comes here. So through that is transcochlea. Then presigmoid, retrolabral. It is posterior to the labyrinth. So after going here, it is, we are curving and then going like this. Okay, so that become presigmoid, retrolabral. Then there are a whole range of infralabyrinthine approaches that is yet to be discussed. Then comes a retrosigmoid, litrolabyrinthine, via totally. That is like this. The incision will, the approach will be like this. The all this much of part will be removed in a retrosigmoid, retrolabyrinthine, via totally. So these are the approaches for excision of vestibular short arm.